Hi, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to ILHAM. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you this afternoon to the first lecture in the ILHAM Public Lecture Series. This series of lectures will feature renowned art historians, academics, and researchers from the region and beyond. They will be held 3 times a year and will give members of the public the opportunity to hear from major scholars in the field. As a public art space, ILHAM places a great deal of importance on education. Our public programs are not there just to support the exhibitions, but they play a vital role in the way we interact with our audiences and the larger public. This project is a collaboration with the Visual Art Department, Cultural Center, University of Malaya. And we would like to invite my colleague, who is a senior lecturer in the Visual Art Department, Dr. Simon Soon.
I'm just going to very quickly read out something. So thank you very much for coming to the inaugural lecture of the of ILHAM Public Lecture. I want to thank ILHAM Gallery for recognizing the importance of art historical scholarship and for supporting this endeavor. This is envisioned as a long-term collaboration between ILHAM Gallery and the Visual Art Department of the Cultural Center at the University of Malaya. Of course, what is also wonderful about this opportunity is that Rahel and I get to work together again. And with ILHAM Public Lectures, we agree that we want to promote research that we believe to possess public significance by prominent scholars of Southeast Asian art. Our goal here is educational because we recognize that over and beyond the building of infrastructural sort of like edifices and the development of personality cults, we need to think long term and create a brain trust. In economic speak, we call this sort of like the development of human capital, right? But I like to think of it more as cultivating one's own imagination and creating a space for a more robust public discourse on the arts. So how we have structured the program goes something like this. There will be 3 ILHAM public lectures a year, as described by Rahel. Invited speakers will be flown into Malaysia over the weekend. On Friday, a postgraduate student seminar is conducted by the invited speaker at the University of Malaya for the students of the MA of Visual Arts program. This is the only program so far dedicated to the study of art history and visual culture in Malaysia at the moment. Yesterday, we had Professor T.K.Sabapathy giving our students a very stimulating talk at the Asian Art Museum at the University of Malaya, where he discussed the nature of art writing, the role that university art museums played and should play, as well as the various challenges art historians face in negotiating one's reality in relation to the nation, the region, and the world. Right? We hope that future speakers will continue to inspire our students at the university and the general Malaysian public through the ILHAM Public Lecture Series. So please look out for our future round announcements for the events to come. Right, thank you.
Can I invite Valentine Willey, Creative Director of ILHAM, to introduce our speaker?
I don't need that. I can use that. Okay. That work? Good afternoon. Thank you for coming to our first public lecture. It gives me a singular pleasure to welcome our first speaker, who is a dear friend, old friend, Kanaga Sobi, who wrote the book that I read when and co-wrote a book with Piadasa, the book called Modern Artists of Malaysia, which I still read and dip into today. And it really is the beginning of my education on Malaysian art. So it's a distinct pleasure for me to welcome him to deliver the first public lecture. We are honored today because one of our foremost historian, curator, and critic, who devoted his life to research, documentation, and support of contemporary visual art in Singapore and Malaysia, and the wider region, I might add. He is the author of the seminal publications as Vision and Idea, Relooking Modern Malaysian Art, and his monographic studies of artists include Said Ahmad Jamal, Yeojin Leng, Latif Muhyiddin, Reza Piadasa, have made significant benchmark in developing the critical literature on artists in Southeast Asia. He's currently the adjunct professor in the Department of Architecture in National University of Singapore, where he teaches the history of art. Today, he will be speaking to us on the early beginnings of academic teaching of history of art in Malaysia and Singapore, and the legacy of Michael Sullivan, who was his mentor. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor T.K.Sabapathy.
Thank you, Valentine, Rachel, and Simon, for this invitation. And when it was suggested to me, I said yes instantly. In part because, and I will be talking a little bit more about that in the course of delivering my reminiscences of my long-standing affair with Malaysia, which started in 1957 and has continued in a roller coaster manner, but never ever diminished. I was just remarking to Marion just now, I don't know why, but hell, I love KL. I come here and curse and swear, but I still come back and continue to love it. I will be talking of a time that was incredibly exciting for me and those of us who stepped out of our homes, our fairy tale, at that time it was, kampungs, little communities, and into the university, which we thought was at that time an enormous leap into the world. It was the world for us. And it was an extremely privileged one because something like 0.08% of the population at that time gained entry into the university. And to be one was to be top of the heap. So in my reminiscences, I may sound a little glassy-eyed about it, so bear with me. I'm unashamed about my emotions and my recollections and unembarrassed about how I recall the past. Just to set the scene, the University of Malaya was established in 1949, located in Singapore. Interestingly enough, the original and preferred location was Skudai in Johor. I don't know whether that's a blessing or not, but there you go. And there was some to-ing and fro-ing, and the vote went to Singapore. On the site of the old Raffles College, there were then, in before the Second World War, two colleges. Raffles College, which was the College for the Humanities, from which came out the streams of civil servants and school teachers who serviced the colonial service at the lower levels, and King Edward VII Medical College, which was the medical college. So the University of Malaya in 49 combined these and expanded on it. And it was constituted to serve citizens of Malaya. I'm going to use this word, which may, it's not a mispronunciation on my part when I refer to Malaya, it's deliberate. There was Malaya and Malaysia, and we all slipped into many formations, sometimes nations, sometimes locations, sometimes just vaguely discerned places. Citizens of Malaya, Brunei, and Singapore. In 1954, a committee recommended setting up two divisions or campuses of that same said University of Malaya. One in Singapore, retaining it, and the other in Kuala Lumpur. So it was to be University of Malaya in Kuala Lumpur, University of Malaya in Singapore, which came about in 1957. And 57 was no accidental year. It was the year of Merdeka. And with the formation of Malaya, it was decided that the first batch of students must reside in Kuala Lumpur. And I was in that batch. So that was my first entry, not literally, because I have family in Penang and in Kuala Lumpur, but as a kind of a bona fide resident here. And the entire Department of Humanities, all the students were shunted here, and we cohabited with students of the Technical College in Jalan Gurney. I don't know what the building is like now. Directly opposite, and we were unfazed by it then, the Police Academy, who were our friends. So that happened in 1957. I'll come back to that in a while. In 1958, a Faculty of Engineering was inaugurated in Pantai Valley. And that, with that began the campus, of the new campus of the University of Malaya in Kuala Lumpur. And finally, in 1963, two separate universities were constituted, University of Malaya, which is at Pantai Valley, and University of Singapore. So my class graduated from the University of Malaya, went on to the University of Malaya in Singapore, and we came out graduates as University of Singapore. How's that? Rather checkered. So the period I'm describing was quite tumultuous at that time. It was for us at the age of 17, 18, the first glimmer of world politics, the shifts in world politics from the tremors of what is to happen after colonial and coloniality. We heard about the Afro-Asian Conference in 1955 because daily in the newspapers there were reports of Chou En Lai flying through Kallang Airport at that time, Jawaharlal Nehru coming through, Abdul Gamal Nasser coming through, and these were all printed in half-size papers. We knew about that. So entering the university was a way of getting to know this world, so we thought. And part of that expectation was realized. In other parts, we were thrown back into the colonial encampment from which we came, especially in the study of, what do you expect, English literature, which there is a department of English literature which stopped with Thomas Hardy. And that was the extent to which we talked about literature per se, let alone English literature or literature written in the English language. So that was the second of my majors. I enrolled in two majors and one minor. And the other was history, which then began to dismantle the whole colonial apparatus and talk about colonial and into wars of independence. In the study of history, we never knew that there was anything prior to the coming of the white man. India started with the landing of Clive. Singapore and Penang began with Francis Light and Stamford Raffles. China started with the Opium War. Nothing, we knew nothing existed before the Opium War. And Japan with the euphemistic called opening of Japan. Sounds very obscene, but there you are. That was the kind of milieu in which art history came in. So I begin. I have prepared a text and I will largely read it, I hope, with some interest. I also have assembled a number of images which will serve more as illustrations of moments, places, persons, rather than requiring a pause from me to talk about them at length, which would be the case if it was a more conventional art history deliberation. July 1958. In the latter half of that month, students who had enrolled in 1957 and completed their freshman in the Faculty of Arts filtered, oh, here we go, sorry. It gets a little halting at the beginning. Okay. Filtered into the Ui Tiong Ham Hall, University of Malaya in Singapore. This is the hall I'm referring to. This is the main campus at that time. This was the library. This was the administrative block. We call this the lower quadrangle, that the upper quadrangle. And these buildings consisted of offices for academic staff, lecture rooms, tutorial rooms. This is where the learning took place. These were residences, and back then were two buildings devoted to canteens. This was a... Vader's torchlight. Yeah, it's here. The museum which I will be talking about was located just here. Subsequently, there were residence halls that were built here and all around. But this was the center of the then university and stayed that way till almost 65. We had completed the freshman year in Kuala Lumpur, returning to Singapore to continue undergraduate studies. And the reasons for being in Kuala Lumpur I have touched upon. On entry into the second year, which is 58, we were required to register in two principal subjects and in one at the subsidiary level. Principal and subsidiary correspond with major and minor, or major and elective today. Students pursued studies of subjects in both categories for two academic years, continuously, at the end of which one qualified for, or really was offered a placement in pursuing an honors degree in the fourth year in one of the principal subjects. I enrolled in English literature and history as principal subjects, completing undergraduate studies with an honors degree in history. Among the subjects offered at the subsidiary level was the history of art, and this is how I remember it. On entering, on a table in Ui Tiong Ham Hall on that July registration day was a sheet of paper propped against a folded card bearing in bold, History of Art. We have never come across that appellation ever in our lives. Below it was a kind of disclaimer, which I recall as saying, no need to demonstrate abilities to draw or paint. Familiar. Below that was a kind of inducement, which I recall vividly. It said, interest in the imaginative use of language, an advantage. And towards the bottom of the sheet was an invitation to sign on. All this was manual. And near its very bottom edge was printed, Instructor Michael Sullivan. At this table was seated on that day, not Michael Sullivan, but Eunice Theo, a lecturer in history who 2 years later supervised the writing of my honors dissertation in history. A generous and attentive teacher. While seated at that table, she smiled at us and said, and I remember this very clearly, don't worry, it'll be a fun course. The impact of the disclaimer vis-a-vis no need to demonstrate abilities to draw or paint was not apparent until much later in my professional life. I will leave it at that. If you want to take it up later, very good. Although it was at that time a relief to me and others as well, because visual or pictorial representation as a subject worthy of study was completely unknown in our schooling, If that was a requirement, we would not have qualified. The effect of the inducement, on the other hand, i.e. interest in the imaginative use of language as being an advantage, was immediate and enduring. About 16 students signed up for this subsidiary. I have identified, of course, I'm the protagonist for this story here, but the two persons who will, not that I discount all of my ex-classmates, two persons who will be seminal in my narrative, Michael Sullivan, our instructor, and his wife, just as, if not more formidable than him, and for good reasons. Right, about 16 students signed up for this subsidiary. Lectures were scheduled twice weekly, each for an hour. Tutorials were held every 2 weeks. The first year of the art history course was devoted to the study of traditions of Asian art. For the very first time, we knew that there was an earlier history for Asia, primarily from India and China, partially from Japan and, as it was then called, Persia, and fleetingly from Southeast Asia. We traversed immense swaths of geography and history, effortlessly, week after week, from the Indus Valley to the domains of the Cholas in southern India between the 10th to the 14th century, and then moving from the Huanghe to the courts of the southern Sung, and on to the dynastic courts of the Yuan, and then into the Ming dynasty. The Qing, anything after the 18th century, was terra incognito. We didn't know anything about it, and nobody was interested. I'll come back to that later. In dealing with India, the focus was on sculpture, wherein the world was rendered palpable by carving and modeling. In China, the focus was on painting, especially landscape painting, whereby aspirations for being one with and in nature were seen as conveyed by brush and ink. So you have two examples, one of the most, I think, arresting images produced by the Chola kings in their court, and Ma Yuan's walking on a path in spring from the southern Sung, as exemplars in a way. Southeast Asia was illustrated fleetingly. Four lectures were devoted to this region. We gained initial glimpses into arduous pathways for circumambulating and ascending Borobudur, into designs of imperial cosmologies for rulers such as Suryavarman II and Jayavarman VII in Angkor. Angkor Thom is under the aegis of Jayavarman VII. And somewhat quickly into pottery and ceramic vessels produced in Thailand and Vietnam as export ware circulating in the region. In the second year, history of art lectures spanned equally expansive geographies and histories, this time from the Egypt of the Pharaohs to the Paris of Picasso, gliding over the Nile and the Athens through the cathedrals of Gothic Europe, and then into the Florence of the Medicis, and stopping at Picasso in Paris at La Demoiselle d'Avignon, at the cusp of the 20th century in Europe, so as it is written in the history. All of this sounds improbably impressive, and it was for all of us in the years 1958 to 1960. A lecture was for 50 minutes. Its delivery was introductory. Artworks were selectively shown. They highlighted what we recognized much later as masterworks. Even so, we were impressed deeply and consistently. We did not miss a single lesson. We did in the others, but not in this. There are two reasons explaining our abiding interest. Firstly, a course such as this was completely novel. There was nothing like it in our entire schooling, not at the primary, not at the secondary and pre-university levels. Pictures never featured in our studies. It was unthinkable that human beings represented the world visually, pictorially, and did so with purpose and thoughtfully. It was even more unthinkable that such representations may be studied seriously and deeply, and that studies of such representations may yield knowledge and may spur ways of knowing. No, our scope of learning was not marked by any of these possibilities. So, when we enrolled in the history of art in 1958, it was because of one, curiosity, and two, its very strangeness. Of course, the world of visual images, the world constituted by visual images, was not illuminated in and of itself. Neither did it appear as intelligible all at once through self-disclosure. We had a teacher who shaped and gradually illuminated such a world, Michael Sullivan. And I deal with the second reason as an explanation. I know this looks nondescript, but it's important for us. Twice weekly, he walked into a lecture hall. The lecture hall was situated on the first floor of this building. You went up a flight of stairs and in there. It's now been converted into offices, so I couldn't take a picture of the auditorium as such at the time that I visited there. But in truth, it was a lecture hall, but a lecture hall for chemistry. So there were all these lab tables all around, and we had to maneuver our way between these lab tables, which somehow was appropriate for the study of art history. Twice weekly, he walked into a lecture hall, Michael Sullivan, carrying a box of slides, glass mounted, in one hand, and a thin file consisting of loose sheets of paper, presumably notes to himself, tucked under one arm. I say presumably because besides flipping through these sheets at the beginning, I do not recall him consulting them during a lecture. By the way, there were no handouts with schedules of lectures and their topics. There were no handouts with summaries of content of what is said in any one session. There were no handouts with recommended readings and study guides. There was no nothing. Readings and tutorial topics were posted on a notice board in a study room in the art museum. If you did not read these notices, then you just did not know. Back to the lecture room. Sullivan handed the slides to an assistant who filed them into a carousel, fed the carousel into a projector. All this sounds seems so strange, huh? But it, you know, the thing is to go click, 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 round and round. It's like listening to a projector in a 30-cent matinee down the road. Fed the carousel into a projector, dimmed the lights, and projected images onto a wall for an entire lecture, every lecture. Sullivan stood beside a long table, partially facing the screen wall and partially turned towards us and talked about the images. They were predominantly black and white. Each was carefully cropped and evenly lit. Occasionally, a handful was seen in color, illustrating paintings. Images were projected singly and from time to time in pairs for examining details and for comparative viewing. These are standard procedures in art history classes today. In 1958, we had never encountered such a situation before and did not do so in any of the other lectures or subjects. Its full impact, this comparative viewing, was revealed when I embarked upon graduate studies in history of art in the University of California in Berkeley in 1962, when I was immersed in the compelling momentum of survey courses. Survey courses in which works of art and artifacts appeared in ordered arrangement, filing through time and space, coherently, majestically, and with unfailing certitude. Images projected on the screen in pairs conveyed these passages powerfully and seductively. It was while studying in Berkeley too, in a course devoted to art historiography, what's that, sort of, you know, the history of art history, the methods and so on and so forth, it was revealed to us that the projecting of two images beside one another for comparative scrutiny was a teaching device initiated and perfected by Heinrich Wilflin, a renowned art historian of the 1920s, in his lectures on art and its histories in Berlin in the 1920s. Sullivan talked for an entire duration of each lecture, for about 50 minutes, rarely pausing. About 15 to 16 images were projected. They were described, some in greater detail than others, all vividly, and with aims on conveying the seeing of relationships and connections between components visible in the images. Images were analyzed so as to indicate how we might discern they were put together, their arrangement, their design, their composition. There also were hints as to ways by which meaning might be proposed and assigned to images by referring to texts written by diverse hands and by carefully sifting cultural traits and tendencies and relating them to images specifically and generally. It is in dealing with this last mentioned aspect that we were nudged towards developing a sense for seeing images historically and socially, of thinking how and why history might matter in talking about art. Sullivan wove description, analysis, and interpretation of content into intricate yet intelligible patterns of verbal representation. We had never heard language used as vividly, elegantly, and at such heightened levels of purpose as he did, for talking about something else. This is something that I've always felt, is to talk art is to talk about something else. None of this was heard as forced or labored. The focus was on the image, on seeing the work, of course, as it appeared projected on the wall. We did not know the work in any other way at that time. We did not hear what he was saying as replacing the image or as substituting seeing it. Sullivan's description and analysis were heard as somewhat circling the image screen on the wall and hovering close by it. Tutorials were held every 2 weeks in the art museum, in a study room in the museum. There we were permitted to deal with objects in the collection. Here too we were guided into looking closely, seeing at length, seeing at the material makeup, at surfaces and shapes, at appearances, and then developing frames for describing and at times analyzing. We did not lose sight of the artifact, even as we struggled with language clumsily, awkwardly and ineptly, and we did, to talk and write about the work. We were asked to deal with texts for submitting tutorial assignments. These entailed reading publications that were set aside as significant, and I'll mention some of them a little later. In all of this, while this was going on for two academic years continuously, I now recall, because I don't wish to be alone in this, the inducement encountered at the time of signing for the study of history of art in Uitjongham Hall. You may recall it was interest in the imaginative use of language and advantage. Well, no other teacher in my undergraduate years employed language as Sullivan did. and I'm not alone in recalling his impact. I give you another voice from another location. Jerome Silbergeld, currently professor of Chinese art history at Princeton University, was Sullivan's student while he was pursuing graduate studies at Stanford University, where Sullivan was professor of Oriental art from 1966 to 1985. Here is Silbergeld on his teacher, and I quote, "Michael Sullivan was the last of my teachers. He has a wonderfully relaxed disposition. He's perhaps even a touch shy, very much a gentleman, and always gracious. It's hard to pinpoint how I most benefited from him, but two ways he inspired me come to mind. One is his eloquence." This might seem a little strange to hear someone talk like this. If you are going to talk about something beautiful, whoever talks about anything beautiful these days, you'd better say it beautifully. That's even more curious. Or you're not being true to your subject. Michael Sullivan had a gift for communicating his subject. The other thing about him is his extraordinary breadth. Even among teachers of his generation, there are few with such range across geography and varied media, from Southeast Asian trade porcelain to the meeting of Eastern and Western art to Chinese dynastic paintings. There's hardly anything he doesn't have a grasp of. This kind of breadth isn't possible any longer, and maybe isn't even appreciated. But I admire it greatly, as humbling as it is to compare oneself to. I've somehow resisted the usual degree of area specialization myself. Who was Michael Sullivan? I'll give you a short profile. He was born Michael Donovan Sullivan in 1916 in Toronto, Canada, Irish Canadian. And that made a difference. He wasn't quite a Pakka Sahib amidst all the other Anglo-Saxon lectures that we had in the university then. He kept apart from them. The family moved to and lived in England with brief stays in Italy and France. Between 1936 and 39, he enrolled in Cambridge University to study architecture. On graduating, he worked in an architect's office, leaving quickly, as prospects for developing a satisfying practice were limited. Even as his involvement in architecture was brief, it was useful in his later professional life. He joined five others and formed a pacifist group called the Relief Committee, intending to provide medical supplies in trucks driven by each of them to the Republican factions in the Spanish Civil War. These plans did not materialize. Alternatively, in 1940, Sullivan joined, well, the International Red Cross as a volunteer serving in China, which was reeling under the invasion of the Japanese. He was a truck driver, delivering medical supplies to voluntary missions in cities in China. By all accounts, he was one hell of a driver. While stopping over at the Canadian mission in Chengdu, we are now in China, he was served tea by a young lady. This is his recollection. "One afternoon, Gordon Jones, who was in charge of his mission, said to me, 'My wife is out. So, Miss Wu is going to pour tea.' She was wearing a simple cheongsam with her hair neatly gathered behind her head. Later, she appeared in light blue slacks that fitted her slender form perfectly and a white shirt. She had loosened her hair, which now hung in a dark cloud about her shoulders." You can know what the end of this story is. I mean, he's had it. "I had never seen a girl like this in China or elsewhere." I wonder if Michael ever got around. "Or elsewhere for that matter, who looked so liberated and independent, so young and so beautiful. I was really surprised that she was already 22 years old with pre-med Bachelor of Science from Santo Tomas, the Jesuit University in Manila. She waved to us and was gone. That vivid moment was imprinted on my mind forever. End of quote. Michael was smitten for life. Quickly, he married her. Sullivan and Miss Wu Bohan, also known as Cohen, that's how she was fondly referred to, and we all were introduced to her as such, were married in 1943. I think there's a photograph of the two of them. I introduce you to Michael Sullivan. Cohen and Michael were inseparable. He repeatedly acknowledges how important she had been in his professional life. She made connections, she built bridges, she persuaded patrons to donate artworks to consolidate collections. While he was the curator of the art museum in the then University of Malaya in Singapore, let me just check my illustrations. Yes, it's fine. She was his assistant, doubling as his secretary, protecting him and how. She sat at a table in a connecting space between the study and his office. As students, if anyone wished to meet with Sullivan, we had to furnish a reason to Cohen and convince her of our need to see him. She never denied entry or access to him, but it was regulated and not a free flow of movement. She was his partner professionally. Virtually all of his publications are dedicated to Cohen. Here is one, which is one of his most recent publications, which is a reworking of an earlier one, Art and Artists of 20th Century China. And there, I think he says, which he has never said, perhaps, because he was sensing this was his last publication, to Cohen as always. That's for sure. Let me just say, this is the ground plan. This was Michael Sullivan's office. This was the study where we were most of our waking hours while attending the university, which was also a library, a wonderful library at that time. And the artworks were all displayed all around here. And this is where Cohen sat. So if we wanted to go from there through there, she was like the Dwarapala, you know, the door guardian. Benign, but demanding, as all door guardians are. Cohen, I step back a little now to fill up the profile of Michael Sullivan. I'll be oscillating between different time phases, not necessarily in a linear way. Cohen facilitated Michael's entry into the world of art. Cheng De Kun, a renowned archaeologist, wrote to her, inviting her to be his English-speaking assistant at West China University in Chengdu. She directed that invitation to Michael, replying to Cheng De Kun that he was better suited. He signed on as his assistant and lived in housing on the university campus in Chengdu. In this university was a collection of Tibetan artifacts. He set about learning to catalog them, to annotate, to describe each one of them, and issued his first publication titled A Manual Introduction to Tibetan Culture. He assisted Cheng De Kun in excavating tombs of rulers dated to the end of the Tang Dynasty. He recorded these by producing drawings of sites and artifacts. The drawings of sites and artifacts are meticulous, architect's drawings, measured drawings. And he is reprising what he learned as a student of architecture. And this is something that stayed with Michael right throughout. And by compiling reports, which were published. Sullivan says of these activities, and I quote, through working with Professor Cheng, I learned a lot about Chinese history and archaeology, and about scholarly methods. I'm quite sure that all of that influenced my future development and gave me a firm foundation. He studied brush painting with an artist named Guan Xuanye. In Chengdu, artist teachers who were among the vanguard of the new painting, dubbed as the moderns, and there were several of them, gathered in the Sichuan Provincial Academy. Sullivan was acquainted with them. In 1944, the Modern Art Society in Chengdu held its first exhibition. Sullivan assembled notes from conversations with these artists, from visiting their studies and viewing their works, very much like what we do now. Cohen was indispensable for these conversations and visits, as he was not quite proficient in the Chinese language at this time. The material gathered from such meetings formed the basis for the first book-length publication in the English language on the modern in Chinese art. Its title, Chinese Art in the 20th Century, published by Faber and Faber in 1959. We were so excited when the book came out and he showed it to us and we thought, wow, we not only have a teacher, we have a writer in our midst. And that was amazing because in all the other courses, we were reading texts by faceless and bodiless writers who were just names. And here was the man who wrote, who is the man who taught us. Quite astonishing. Sullivan recalls and installs it as dramatically framing the tense, conflicting circumstances in which the modern is represented in Chinese art, and, he adds, in all of Asia. His report resonates with critical and historical conceptions of the modern in art today. It merits close reading, which, however, is beyond the scope of this presentation. I take enormous liberties in arranging for quick exits from China for these two, because we've got to get him to me. So Sullivan says in 1946, I want to go home to England. I want Cohen to meet my family, and I want to study Asian art history as a career. So, back in England, London, he began studies in art history in the Courtauld Institute in London in January 1947, which of course had nothing to do with the teaching of Asian art. He enrolled there because, presumably, there were no accredited degree programs for majoring in Asian art history in the United Kingdom, and there still are very, very, very few. To study art history is to study the histories of European art. He left after 6 months, he left the Courtauld, and was awarded a scholarship to study Chinese language and literature at the School of Oriental and African Studies, University of London, for 3.5 years, from 1947 to the end of 1950. In 1950, he proceeded to Harvard on a Rockefeller Foundation scholarship for doctoral studies in Chinese art. He had to go to the States for that, completing them in 1952, and then on to a postdoctoral fellowship for 2 years in the very same institution. His dissertation was on the beginnings of landscape painting in Chinese art, the very first on this topic. This is my well-thumbed copy of it. It was published in 1962 as The Birth of Landscape Painting in China by the University of California Press, Berkeley, the very year I arrived there to study Southeast Asian art and was told, there is no Southeast Asian art here. Why don't you study Chinese art? It's close enough to Southeast Asia. I said, of course, and I did. Proximity is virtuous. With this publication, Sullivan is installed at the epicenter of Chinese art history as a field. The majority of his writings, and they are on Chinese art, have been published by this press, the University of California Press. I know of no writer or scholar in Asian art who is as consistently and singularly represented by one publisher as is Sullivan. I just give a brief summary of this book, so bear with me, because I think it's important to say this. The birth of landscape painting in China is the first to deal with the beginnings of the most esteemed picture categories in China. Its scope spans from antiquity to the six dynasties, that i.e. 581 of the Common Era. Sullivan's surveys known archaeological, ritual, pictorial, and textual resources from available published Chinese and Western collections closely. He examines their formal, stylistic, and symbolic attributes, the three foundational criteria and grounds for the study of history of art then, ordering them chronologically. He analyzes and interprets these resources and attributes, directing his scholarship towards unfolding historical perspectives for appraising early representations of landscape in China. The account is piecemeal and fragmentary. Sullivan resists temptations to coerce his resources into assuming smooth, rounded, and connected wholes. Still, his aim is to provide an account that is historical. It is still today the extant publication on the topic. In a survey of Chinese painting studies published in 1987, the birth of landscape painting in China is listed as extremely significant. Even as it breaks new ground, its importance is measured in relation to past and prevailing studies in the field of Chinese art. I am saying the obvious. In this respect, Sullivan acknowledges his scholarly debt. In doing so, he discloses his art historical genealogy. Among those he names are, and bear with these may not be familiar names to you, they were meat and drink for us at that time, Benjamin Rowland, William Acker, Lawrence Sigmund, Alexander Soper, the master teacher scholars of Asian art history in the English-speaking world in the 1950s and 1960s. And the 16 students who enrolled in the history of art course as a subsidiary subject in 1958, Moore included, encountered them attentively and reverently. In the art museum in the university, which I'll talk about shortly, was a study. In it were shelves of publications displaying a range of formidable tomes, thick, leather-bound, and arranged according to topics. When dealing with art in Asia, we read three publications frequently. They were, this, believe it or not, is a book cover. They were The Art and Architecture of India by Benjamin Rowland, The Art and Architecture of China by Lawrence Sigmund and Alexander Soper, and The Art and Architecture of Japan by Robert Payne and Alexander Soper. They were published by Penguin and issued as a series titled The Pelican History of Art under the general editorship of Nicholas Pepsner. You couldn't imagine publishing a book with a cover like that now, of any description, least of all an art book. Unthinkable. So you can imagine what the contents are like. They were austere publications, heavy, heavy duty stuff. Each was made up of 320 pages hardback. Two thirds were text with illustrations only in black and white of paintings, shunted to the very back. You read page after page after page after page of text. You turned to the back in order to consult the illustrations that were mentioned in the text and worked, sorry for the unparliamentary language, bloody hard to match the text with the image, often missing that connection. In these publications, texts prevailed. We loop back to 1954, to the end of Sullivan's postdoctoral fellowship at Harvard. As he tells it, he read an advertisement in, of course, the Times of London, for a position as a lecturer in history of art in the University of Malaya in Singapore. He was surprised by it. He was also advised against applying for it, as he would be heading nowhere, in which there was nothing, and that it would not advance his career. He applied and was offered the position. He was, he reckoned, the only applicant. It is not improbable that he applied because he was curious, and darn it, he needed a job, and that there were not many positions for art historians in Asian art. In fact, none, except in the States, three universities. And that he would be in a vicinity near China, which constitutes his field of study. The University Gazette, University of Malaya Gazette, announced that Dr. M. Sullivan had been appointed as a lecturer on history of art. That's the press photograph of their arrival. It was published in the States Times, important enough then. Cohen and Michael arrived in Singapore in 1954. It was newsworthy to be reported. There were two reports on consecutive days, July the 27th and July the 28th, 1954. On July 27th, there appeared a short notice with the headline, "An Art Man with a Plus Four Job," remarking, again, as the Times of London advised him, that Dr. Sullivan was walking into a no man's land, implying that he was wading into artistic, culturally uncultivated terrain. A popular expression then was a cultural desert. Sullivan was surprised to read the advertisement. Let us use that as a lead. Why was there such an academic position when there isn't one now? After all, the study of arts history as an academic discipline was not prevalent in British tertiary institutions, and even less in colonial outposts such as Singapore, Malaya. For clues, we step back a little and briefly recall a report put together in 1948 by a commission set up by the Colonial Office in London for establishing a university here. It is referred to as the Carr Saunders Report, after Alexander Carr Saunders, a chairperson, and it proposed, I was so astonished when I read this, that the history of art be taught in 1948, formally at the undergraduate levels in the newly formed university. It recommended, amazingly still, that a faculty appointment be made at a senior status, signaling, quite obviously, the importance it attached to the course and the position. As there is no indication why such a course be included specifically and what it might be in the report, it is assumed that everybody would know what art history is, and everybody would know of its intrinsic worthiness. The report gave, however, expansive reasons for its recommendations. The teaching of history of art, it said, and I quote, would in fact fit well into many courses such as language, literature, sociology, history. None of it has come true. It would be essential if at some future time architecture be taught at the university, which it was in 1969. When we began studying it in 1958, there were no connections between the learning of the history of art and the teaching of, say, history and literature, because I was enrolled in those three, in those two either. Sullivan says as much, and I quote, "I just did my own thing." There's a virtue in that. "I was completely free to devise the course I wanted without any reference to what was taught elsewhere. Of course, the history department, there they taught the history of Southeast Asia and so on, and the history of Asia as well as the West. So of course there were some parallel things going on, but we didn't connect, or there was no integration between these causes. Never. End of quote. The claim that the study of history of art is essential for architecture is even more surprising. The report does not hint at how and why it might be so. Be that as it may, and bear with me while I enter into a minor digression here, a school of architecture was established in the university in 1969. In 1981, 12 years later, the school decided to offer the history of art at an introductory level in the first year of studies. The aim was to widen the scope of students gathering access to historical sources critically and creatively, and to enhance visual acuity. In that year, I was appointed to teach this subject and continue to do so until today, having ended my tenure in USM in Penang the year earlier. Sullivan arrived in 1954. He needed time and resources to develop the lecture course. A two-year curriculum for introducing the history of art was set up, and I have already described it. He began teaching in 1955 and continued to do so until 1960. The class of 1958, and I was in it, was the last during his tenure in Singapore. He left in 1960. In tandem with teaching, he suggested setting up a collection of art to enhance the learning of arts history. In October 1954, a proposal for setting up a museum was tabled. It was approved. On April the 7th, 1955, the University Art Museum was inaugurated. It was the first and only museum of art in Malaya and Singapore, and interestingly enough, located in a university. Sullivan was its first curator, thereby assuming a dual role, lecturer in art history and curator of an art museum. The two, that is art history and curating, are assumed to be compatible even to today, although they may not be, and I have decided views on this. During its existence between 1955 to 1973, the University Art Museum was oriented and developed along a dual track. During his tenure, Sullivan elaborated upon and developed and energetically publicized the aims of the museum, its programs, as well as the teaching of the history of art. He did so through exhibitions, by researching and publishing on art in a variety of print medium, by giving public lectures, and by engaging with art and artists in Malaya and Singapore. His aims may be summarized as follows. One, to locate in the university a center for the study and, how nice, enjoyment of art. Two, to provide a two-year program in history of art at the subsidiary level. Three, this is interesting, to create a center for research into the art and archaeology of Southeast Asia. Four, interesting, to bring together a representative collection of the art of those civilizations and cultures that impinge upon the creation of Malayan culture. The creation of Malayan culture. In all these respects, Sullivan was entering unknown, unfamiliar terrain. His academic training, remember, was in Chinese art. Southeast Asia did not feature in it at all. Yet, he was not deterred, committing his attention and resources unhesitatingly to grapple with new museological and archaeological enterprises. I provide details on some of these matters and begin by reporting on Sullivan's forays into, yes, archaeology. We recall his association with Cheng Tagun, excavating the tombs of late Tang Dynasty rulers. He reprised his involvement during his tenure here, leading and partaking in excavations, especially in the state of, well, Kedah in 1957. The history department in that university then was actively, deeply involved in a number of archaeological projects. Wangangu, Alistair Lamb, D.K. Bassett, all of whom were our teachers in history, were among others, were frequently featured in surveying, excavating, newly recovering earlier sites explored by H.G. Quatrich Wales before the Second World War. These were developed in close association with the Museum Department of the Federation of Malaya and the then Raffles Museum. Lengthy reports were compiled and published. These consisted of cataloging artifacts and materials that were retrieved, describing sites in detail, drawing foundations of buildings and site plans. Again, Sullivan's training in architecture was of immense help and illuminated these reports, and reconstructing histories of local settlements, as well as proposing regional, i.e. Southeast Asian, connections or affiliations. Sullivan wrote one such report. It was published as, and I quote, "Excavations in Kedah and Province Wellesley in the Journal of the Malayan Branch of the Royal Asiatic Society in 1958. It was extensive, covering 31 pages. I am not competent to appraise these or any field notes compiled and published by Sullivan and leave assessing the status of his involvement with archaeology to those better placed to do so. What I can say is that his involvement fed into the museum. From his 1957 expedition, he assembled a number of artifacts from excavated sites with the consent of the Kedah state government in an exhibition in the university's art museum. I remember this very vividly. It left deep impressions in many in the class of 1958. It was thrilling, but absolutely thrilling then to us, to behold things that had been recently unearthed from human settlements about 1,000 years earlier. He gave public lectures on this and other archaeologically related subjects. He traveled to Indonesia, the Philippines, Vietnam, Cambodia, and Thailand, forging connections with museums, archaeologists, collectors and collections, and prospective donors, all for developing the University Art Museum. If the region was unknown when he arrived in Singapore in 1954, he set about familiarizing himself with it by entering it. It affected his scholarship, though. His new activities rivaled, competed with research into art of China. No, he did not set China aside, but it was difficult to continuously cultivate the home base of his scholarship and to do so as a premier site. China was not accessible. Sullivan, along with Cohen, revisited it only in 1973, 27 years after leaving it in 1940. It was difficult too during his tenure because Malaya was in the midst of armed conflict with the Malayan Communist Party, whose principal patron was Communist China. Links with Communist China for whatever purpose were untenable. During the years in the university, Sullivan published 5 articles on Chinese art. The majority of these were derived from his doctoral dissertation, which is run-of-the-mill stuff. One recycles dissertations, where he reworked material that he was already familiar with. His principal attention, though, was on the region of Southeast Asia, chiefly on the art of its traditional past. We press on with events that make up this account. I just want to round up Sullivan's sort of movement. Sullivan quickly departed from Singapore in 1960, headed to London, where he assumed a position as a lecturer in Chinese art at the School of Oriental and African Studies, University of London, returning to where he began his studies on Chinese language and literature. He published The Birth of Landscape Painting in China in 1962, which I looked at and talked a little. numerous reviews of Chinese art exhibitions held in institutions on both sides of the Atlantic, and books on Chinese art, along with articles on topics as varied as ceramics, bronzes, paintings, jade, followed prolifically. Quickly, in 1965, there appeared a number of articles. Okay, I don't think I'll list them right now. Even so, although he was once in London drawn back to the primary field of his research, he regarded the work he had produced during his tenure in the university here as important enough to republish it in two volumes, titled, significantly, Studies in the Art of China and Southeast Asia in 1992. He did so, no doubt, in order to reinsert himself in the art scholarship of this region. Although the region faded from his academic horizon and disappeared from his scholarly resume, it continued to prevail in his thinking, in his teaching, and in his life. It must have done so for us to make sense of Jerome Silbergell's admiring recollection of Sullivan's extraordinary breadth, where he says, even among teachers of his generation, there were few with such range across geography and media. It may sound as if I'm about to say goodbye to Sullivan. Alas, not yet. A little bit more needs to be said. While reporting on, and the more interesting thing is coming now, when reporting on Sullivan's archaeological involvement, I remarked that it fed into the University Art Museum. Objects were selected, acquired, loaned for display, via his connections with the region's archaeological circle. Sullivan's writing on ceramic vessels was, for instance, spurred by artifacts in the museum. The scope of his research, however, was not restricted by what was in the museum. He combed the region's collections and beyond, both public and private, corresponded with museologists in India, Japan, and in Europe, in developing his publication. The University Art Museum was in turn connected quite widely. Here was a separation between the teaching of the art history and the functioning of the museum. Ah, here's an interior of the then museum. This is how it looked like. This is of course the famous rear view of me. And the couple of wonderful classmates at that time, some of whom I'm still in contact with. Okay, yes. A study of kandy, a vessel with a sprout, may be regarded as displaying some of these traits. I discuss it briefly because it is really important. It was published in 1957 in the archives of the Chinese Art Society of America, a prestigious platform. Sullivan begins by dealing with the etymology of the term, kandy, and then proceeds to describe its formal properties in considerable detail, noting differences by comparing vessels with a wide range of provenance in South China, in Southeast Asia, China, and Japan. He illustrates this aspect of his study, displaying varieties of shaped forms. Transformations of shape and form are carefully described, although explanations for alterations are not offered. Sullivan forwards chronological schemes. He speculates on the use of kandy by observing current use, but avoids saying how it was used in particular circumstances historically, which in any case may not be decidable. He consults existing publications widely and sharply. He illustrates his study profusely, so much so the kandy from the university, which is this one, which is this vessel here and here, is crowded out and inserted into an extensive family of such vessels. He includes, he includes a hand-drawn illustration of types of kendi arising from his study. The premises in this study have been undoubtedly superseded by advances in recent scholarship. Even so, at the time of its publication, it was the most thorough and extensive treatment of this type of vessel. The kendi is revitalized in the Museum Seni Asia, Asia, propelled chiefly by the then vice chancellor of the university, Unku Aziz. The collection was expanded, and it takes pride or place. In the university holdings, an entire room is devoted to this ware. In 1979, Unku Aziz published an article in Orientations, in which he revised existing scholarship by redefining the vessel's formal properties, reconsidering its technological dimensions and distribution, and proposing fresh grounds for interpreting its meaning. It is quite an impressive text. He seeks to enhance the status of his own writing and that of the kendi by titling his article, A Theory of Kendi. Of course, in his explanation, there is no theory that is put forward. It's a revision of what takes place. Here is a detail of the illustrations. Of course, those of you who are familiar with Orientations know how lush and lavish the illustrations are. They're quite unmatched in that sense. The study of this vessel is formally installed in the bibliographical world in 1991 when a book-length publication titled Kendi, Pouring Vessels in the University of Malaya Collection, written by Ku Ju-yi, who was then the curator, director, and edited by Don F. Rooney, was issued by Oxford University Press. To my knowledge, all of this is completely forgotten. No one refers to this, no one remembers this, nothing. No one even goes and visits there. I was with Simon's students yesterday, and they confess that they rarely visit the museum, although they are students in the university. It's a complete disconnect. Not all of Sullivan's written representations of art in Southeast Asia are interesting or worthy. The discovery of Angkor, published in 1960, after his departure from Singapore, reiterates standard narratives of the French discovery of a lost civilization. Sullivan occasionally disrupts such conventional accounts by referring to sources other than those routinely used by French writers to underline that there were other kinds of remembering. It is largely written in the tone of a travelogue. Sullivan's publications during his tenure here need to be examined closely in relation to other clusters that make up his body of writings and in relation to writings by other writers, and there were quite a number. So there is much to do. I make one more observation on the University Museum and move on to concluding this account. I keep promising that several times. The Art Museum was recognized as a significant cultural site. Within 3 months of its inauguration, about 1,000 were recorded as having visited it. That's quite astonishing. A measure of the regard the public had for it may be gleaned from the following. On July the 27, 1957, the Straits Times reported that a reader was miffed, completely upset, by an earlier remark by Frank Sullivan. That's a familiar name, isn't it? Frank Sullivan. A journalist who was beginning to be involved in art and artists in Malaya and Singapore, and who played an important in developing the modern here. This, I'm being snarky here, other Sullivan, had said that there were no collections of art in Singapore, and there was no art to be viewed regularly. This miffed reader is quoted as saying that contrary to Frank Sullivan's opinion, there is, and here's a quote, an excellent art collection collectively representative of leading exponents of Malayan art in the University of Malaya Art Collection, close quote. This reader is quoted further as saying that there is in this university, in association of the art museum, a department of history of art. Sullivan may well have been seen as a department. There never was a department, and there never is one presently. There isn't one anywhere in Singapore or Malaya or in Southeast Asia, not in art history. This museum, its collection and exhibition programs have been reported in the daily newspapers. One has to read these and notices published in other sites in order to ascertain the reception of this institution at its founding. When talking about the setting up of the art museum, I listed four aims. In realizing them, a collection was to be assembled with the following categories guiding the collection. One, contemporary Malayan art, Southeast Asian art, stone and metal sculpture, Malay and Islamic art, Indian art, Hindu and Buddhist, ceramic art of China, Thailand, Cambodia, and Vietnam. Huge. Donations and acquisitions fleshed out these categories, although these categories and areas were not developed evenly. The procedure was slow, gradual. The scope for collecting largely affirms prevailing tenets and values of art of the great traditions of Asia, with two exceptions. Firstly, collecting ceramic works from Cambodia, Thailand, Vietnam, and the Philippines was a new enterprise. Until then, ceramics was China, period. And enabling the exploration of new museological and art historical fields. And then, secondly, there is what Sullivan terms as contemporary Malayan art. I'll talk on this a little. As students, we encountered the collection regularly. We used the study room in the museum routinely for working on all our other courses. It was a haven. The collection was displayed by... Oh, no, not yet. Yes. By grouping objects by medium, material, and provenance, which is the very heartbeat of any material collection in a museum. From time to time, there were exceptions to these arrangements. I remember seeing pictures painted in oil and ink by artists from Malaya and Singapore, hung adjacent to ceramic vessels, and partial images of Buddha cast in bronze. It was exhilarating. There was nothing like it anywhere else in Singapore, and as far as we knew then, in Malaya, as I recall. It was part of our daily student lives. I doubt Sullivan intended to convey relationships between these disparate objects forcefully. He may well have intended to provide an environment that was visually stimulating and for provoking curiosity. Among categories for acquiring works is one designated as contemporary Malayan art. Sullivan esteemed it highly, as it revealed, according to him, the state of our cultures. His view was that the student should not only know what was before, but be aware of what is, culturally and historically. He was actively involved with artists and art in Singapore, with organizing exhibitions of their works, not dissimilarly from relationships he forged with the new modern artists who gathered in Chengdu while he was residing in China. Hence, works by artists such as Cheong Soo Pieng, Chua Tian Ting, Surin Bin Mohyani were acquired through donations and purchase. Sullivan installed Cheong Soo Pieng on a register apart from other artists, writing on him more frequently than on any other artist, regarding him as the most innovative, imaginative, and as having immense effect. Here he is assessing this artist, and I quote, "Su Peng's influence on the younger painters of Singapore and Malaya has been powerful and direct, perhaps too direct. His angular figures, formalized portraits, and expressionistic color are the mark of a highly sophisticated painter, the very consistency of whose style has given rise to a school of young painters who copy his forms and colors." And wait for this, "just as the painters in Paris have copied Picasso and Braque." I have not come across a published opinion on Su Peng in the 1950s that is comparable to Sullivan's in sharpness and in exalted tones. Cohen was busily involved in conversations with artists and in dealing with transactions for acquiring works from them for the museum. She could speak in dialect, thereby easing and facilitating relationships along a variety of pathways. And she was appreciated so much so Su Peng is seen in this one instance painting her portrait as a tribute, which is now in the Cohen and Michael Sullivan collection in the Ashmolean in Oxford University. He donated his entire collection, including his library, to Ashmolean. Sullivan's commitment to artists and art here peaked in 1959 when he assumed the chair of the first arts festival in Singapore in that year. He was its director and curator of its visual art program. This matter is largely forgotten and needs to be examined. For the present, I underline that in directing this festival, Sullivan is seen as immersed in the worlds of art here and as a considerable figure for giving these worlds shape and momentum. He in turn signals his immersion significantly in what he says. This affiliation did not emerge in 1959 at the time of the festival suddenly, but it began with his arrival in 1954. While he names artists as being from Singapore, he envisions and represents their creative work not as Singapore art, but as Malayan art. Not as Nanyang, but as Malayan. I have, by the way, not encountered the term Nanyang in any of Sullivan's writings. Here is a matter that could be treated separately. The fullest testimony that he provides to substantiate this is an introduction that he published for an exhibition held in the Victoria Memorial Hall in Singapore. Its title is 10 Years of Art in Singapore. He names Singapore, but in fact, it is about 10 years of art, 10 years of Malayan art. I summarize what he says there. Sullivan identifies three attributes distinguishing artists and art here. They are, firstly, its vigor and youthfulness. Secondly, they are of their time and place, expressive of the land, its people, their social and living conditions. And fourthly, formally and stylistically, they are not derivative. And then he adds a caveat to all of this, or a kind of a rider. They are universal, in the sense that the art that is produced is not entrapped within specific cultural ethnic enclaves, even as it is created by individuals who are identifiable as belonging to specific cultural ethnic enclaves. Artistic creations, according to him, breach crossover stereotypical classifications. Hence, he says, one does not need to, and we will, of course, laugh at the strangeness of this, but at that time, in the claim for cross-cultural bridging and intercourse, so to speak, these were avidly not only expressed, but faithfully believed in, that one need not know Malay as a language to appreciate Surin bin Mohiani, or to know Hokkien to understand Cheong Soo Pyng. This art is the most successive and vivid expression of Malayan culture, and so on. What is Malayan? It's a huge topic, and I'll just make some brief comments of it. As I recall how we envisaged it at the time, in the late 50s and early 60s. The term Malayan signified not so much a delimited location or a boundaried place. It was an ideal, an aspiration, a destiny. It was a real hot term in the late 50s and early 60s, appearing in tandem with moves towards political independence. As an undergraduate, I was, along with others, swept up by forces underpinning it. On one hand, it heralded the shucking off of colonialism and striving for a free, self-determining destination. Malayanization was, for instance, a strategy by which colonial, i.e. British officers, were replaced by local staff and for enhancing local capacities and abilities. Malayan, on the other hand, carried with it cultural assertiveness and creative distinctiveness, spurred by calls to be sharply aware of one's time, place, living and lived experience, concretely and commonly. Malayan also generated prospects for devising new forms of language for representing reality newly. Malayan resonates as modern as well, so it's quite a basket full of things. The university campus was a vital site for debates and counter-debates on the present and future of Singapore and its people, and for representing visions of being Malayan. For all that, it was not completely rosy. Neither did Malayan command support unanimously, as there was resistance and deep-seated suspicion and anxiety. We were convinced. Still, it was proclaimed vigorously and insistently. Sullivan was not the only one who envisaged Malayan as an artistic ideal or as an artistically identifiable trait. There were others dealing with theater, film, literature, architecture, fashion, food, and so on. Here's a small but significant kind of post-colonial trait observation. In writing the 10 years of art in Singapore, Sullivan employed, and I don't think this was a sleight of hand maneuver, the pronouns we and our. I believe this was possible because of his Irishness and his Canadianness. He refers to our painters, our cultures, and recalls situations when we debate. In doing so, he stamps his writing with affiliations with communities here. During his six-year residence here, Cohen and here and he appear deeply involved personally and professionally with artists and art here. Bearing in mind that the art museum in the university was set up to complement and deepen the study of the history of art, was it used for that purpose in the study of history of art? Did Sullivan use it when teaching the history of art? The answer is no, and if yes, it was indirectly and informally. Only that is in tutorials, when he used objects from the collection to spur hands-on approaches. We were nevertheless excited by those close encounters. It was a fledgling collection. Resources for developing it were extremely modest. I imagine, and this is me, Sullivan not considering what was in the collection as suitable for teaching introductory survey histories of art that conventionally dealt with masterworks and that represented history as a tradition of masterworks. The situation may well be different if courses in history of art were taught at higher undergraduate levels as seminars in years 3 and 4. But this was not to be at that time, and it is not so today. Still, we were stimulated by what was in the collection by our regular somewhat routine contact. What's more, we regarded ourselves, all 16 of us, as special and as in a special place with a special person. And then there is the matter of the modern. Sullivan had written on the modern. He was deeply involved with art and artists, with exhibitions and with writing on them. Did he, for instance, talk about Cheong Soo Pyeong or Surin Mokhyani, whom he regarded highly in any of his lectures? The reply is no, he did not. The modern from anywhere in Asia was not featured in the two-year history of art course. Is this surprising or puzzling? Perhaps it is, when it is viewed from the present and from today. We are dealing with a situation in the 1950s and the 1970s. But then even today, the modern and the contemporary in art of Asia are not altogether prevalent in academia, in the halls and corridors of departments of history of art. This is a fascinating topic that another ILHAM gathering, perhaps. I'm fishing for invitations. The survey courses on European art that I attended when studying at Berkeley in 1960s stopped at the end of the 19th century, effectively with Cézanne and the post-impressionists, because the 20th century was not written art historically. The only 20th century artist we glimpsed at was Picasso, and that was because he was Picasso, one of a kind of ahistorical phenomenon. Historians of Asian art did not admit the modern in their teaching and writing. It was looked at as alien. It did not, in effect, exist. Ananda Kumaraswamy, probably the doyen of Asian art historians and Asian art history, for instance, in his writings, frequently dismissed the modern as irredeemably antithetical to the true tenets and principles of Asian art and its philosophies. I have commented on this in other writings. Historians teaching and writing Asian art in Europe and the USA have tended to treat the modern in Asia as derivative and as on a secondary or a third level register. At best, the modern could be handled separately from and outside of the canon of art history. The study of traditional art in Asia, on the other hand, conforms to that canon and is therefore admitted and represented in it. It has the attributes and the status to qualify. I have set the situation starkly so as to make some sense of Sullivan's treatment of the modern, not completely condoning it, in the field of history of Asian art. Sullivan was a teacher of history of Asian art all of his professional life, and his professional life was filled in departments of history of art in university. He is acknowledged as an important source, if not an authority, on the modern in Chinese art. He has published on it. He never taught the modern in his entire life. During his tenure at Stanford, three candidates completed their doctoral dissertation on the modern under his supervision, yet he never taught courses on the modern. I'm sure there are other similar instances. Sullivan has not, to my knowledge, said why he has not, at least not directly. I describe his stance as ambivalent. There is no doubting his interest in modern artists and art. Yet he was not, in my opinion, convinced that he or anyone else at that time had sufficiently studied or treated the modern in art historically in order to represent it rigorously, methodically, and consistently on the basis of bodies of work that are stably consolidated in ways that are comparable to writing histories of traditional Chinese art. That was his criteria. Consider the following testimony forwarded by Sullivan. So he does it in a looping way. When he was asked forcibly in a conversation to talk about this, I quote him, right from the start during the war, I was interested in contemporary Chinese art. In Chengdu, I met a number of artists, and my wife, Cohen, although trained as a scientist, opened doors and built bridges for me wherever we went. If I came to know the world of the modern artists better than my colleagues, who were not interested anyway, that was due to her. But involvement in contemporary art and artists has its problems. The impartial judgment one can make about, say, Yuran or Shenzhou, these are the state stable incorporated into the canonical development of art history. The impartial judgments one can make about artists such as that are far more difficult in modern and contemporary. I was devoted to A, that's his example of a modern contemporary artist, but didn't think he was a very important artist. I found it difficult to be in the same room with B, another, but recognize him as a major figure. And how should I evaluate according to any acceptable criteria? What are they, he's asking? Style and forms that seem to come out of nowhere. Just to say this is happening, so it is significant, is not enough. We recognize that, don't we? For Sullivan, the modern lacked art historical gravitas. His writings on the modern sprang from intimate observations, personal friendships, conversations, and judgments of work that he could view periodically. They were, as one assessor regards them, more like first-person reporting rather than text object-based research, yielding patterns of deeply edged connections in time and space. He could not envisage translating or transforming these anecdotal things into providing stable, curricular-based courses for teaching in undergraduate and graduate levels along connected, flowing historical trajectories. His publications are undeniably useful. They furnish recordings, perspectives, and viewpoints of artists, artworks, and art events that appeared in public in particular circumstances and as he witnessed them. As useful as they are, they were not enough for talking about the modern in art with deep historical interests. These aims were developed continuously, confidently, and authoritatively in the treatment of traditional art in China. And the majority of Sullivan's writings are in that sphere. The ambivalence towards the modern ascribed to Sullivan, especially when relating to the canon of art history, is not particular to him. It is not easy to breach institutional fortifications, to do so with one's own mind and professionally. Here is a confession by a renowned scholar and teacher relating obstacles he confronted when leading the mainstream and peering into the slipstream, James Cahill. It is also a bitter complaint leveled against institutions that he, Cahill, for so long shaped, commanded, and safeguarded and protected. He's now on the outside, trying to get in. In the preface and acknowledgement of one of his last publications titled Pictures for Use and Pleasure, Vernacular Painting in Hai Ching, China in 2010, Cahill writes, and I quote, it's an interesting, very pained confession. The theme of his book and materials it treats are mostly new to scholarship and were not art historically impenetrable until the paintings could be assembled and considered together. That task has required years of looking through odd corners of museums. The writing of this book has drawn me into areas of Chinese studies where I was not entirely at home. He was a classicist. The book was essentially completed by late 2002 and was ready to go into production when the project was scuttled, mainly by the incoming director of a university press. This is the University of California Press, which favored Sullivan so fervently. Of course, they were rivals too. The same press kept my book on, this is a bittersweet complaint of a writer, the same press kept my book on for separate consideration, but firmly rejected it on the basis of lukewarm reports by badly chosen reviewers, of course. It was rescued by Deborah Kirschman, assistant director of the University of California Press, who has my deep gratitude. So eventually, it was published after a wait of almost 10 years. For Cahill, the vernacular sits like the modern for Sullivan, ill at ease at the doors of institutions. I realize this is melodramatic and really needs to be handled much more subtly and considerately. Even so, I said it in this way to underline the complicated perception or appraisal of the modern in Asian art in the academic study of history of art, at least in the case of Sullivan and to extends in Cahill. Believe it or not, I've come almost to the end. If I can prevail on you, I just wish to project two slides, which I rarely do in public presentations, which have to do with me. This is finally Sullivan and I meeting after many, many years at a conference in Singapore in 2008. And don't we sigh about how we were when we were young, and this is Sullivan and I then. Ah, how sweet it was. that was Sullivan after it arrived at SOAS, and that's me the day before I left for California. When describing Michael Sullivan's stance as ambivalent, I'm not suggesting that he might be conflicted in pursuing his professional life. He maintained an equable disposition, largely, in my reckoning, unruffled and relatively cool. He may be seen as navigating the two streams, the great tradition and the modern, along which he thought and wrote on with sufficiently clear eyes, although separately and with unequal art historical importance. We are touched by a kind of wistfulness, even by a mildly deprecating humor, when hearing Sullivan appraise himself. And I quote, "Compared with the American scholars of Chinese art, whom I greatly admire, I seem to have come into the field sideways. That has the advantage that, especially after my years in Singapore, where I became immersed in the art and archaeology of Southeast Asia, I had a broader background than some of my friends in England and the States. On the other hand, they were trained more thoroughly in the discipline of art history. They had better command of the language, Chinese language, and were altogether more professional in their approach. I have a sense that some of them looked at me as something of an amateur of the old school." On this note, I bid Michael Sullivan adieu. I also salute a wonderful guru who introduced me to the world of art and in incalculable ways sustained interest in remaining in that world all of my life. I thank you.
Professor Sabapathy for the very heartfelt lecture. In the interest of saving time, may I sort of invite you to sort of sit here for a short question and answer, right? No, it's not an electric chair, trust me. You won't... Yeah, it's not wired yet. We will. It will be one day. I don't know. They haven't prepared a chair for me, so you just have to sit by yourself first for now. Okay? Please have a seat. Okay. So, the lecture has gone on for an hour and a half. So, in the interest of saving time, does anyone have any questions? And if you do, please raise your hand. Introduce yourself. We have Dixon, it's actually me with the mic. I'll come over to you. Introduce yourself and ask your question.
Who dares have a question?
Anyone? That's a challenge. Come on. Okay, sure.
I suppose you might be mentoring students now as part of your academic work, like what Michael Sullivan has done for you. Like, what sort of words of wisdom you would share with your students? I know it's a very broad question, but if there's anything in particular that interests you that you share with your students.
Let me say that with very, very rare exceptions, I've been teaching undergraduate students at the first and at best, the second year levels. Let's say right now I have a class of 82 students. Art history is not their major, and they will move on to their major disciplines. Occasionally, I have a student who sees the light and abandons the major and says, I want to go the route of the minor and make it the major. So, the first thing I tell that student is, get the hell out of here. And secondly, to say, but make this the field of your study. What would I say to them? If the interest in studying art in this particular way, which is to do with making and enabling the viewing and the talking and the seeing of art with historical interest in what is what interests you, and not everybody is interested in that direction, then what you have to do is really never ever stop reading and never ever stop writing. And I know the reading and the writing are preeminent today. I would like to add a third to it. Preeminently to all of that is the seeing of the work. And how the three are connected is the past and enduring task of studying art historically. I think it has to come from a deep interest. Have I mentored any students? Strictly speaking, in that specific way, no, I have not. Without sounding self-piteous, I have only taught introductory courses in art history. And that doesn't enable one to mentor students, unless some others have a different perspective on how I do and what I do things. I think I penned a testimony which in fact began, the whole journey began with Liu Weng Choi's invitation for me to say something at the substation seminar on the contemporary, where he persuaded me to talk a little bit about my life. And that has been published, a kind of a self-obituary called Road to Nowhere, which is a kind of a take from a Bob Dylan song. I thought about his, what was that he said? an absolute nobody, something like that. Anyway, and that charted the history of what I have said partly, and where I have stopped and where I have pretty much run on the spot. But there have been persons, and there still are persons, with Joy is one of them, Simon is now presently another, with whom I have great, enduring, fertile, and generative collaborations in scholarship, in conversations, in seminars publicly. So to me, the mentorship is collaborative rather than singularly directed as teacher-student. Not that I don't wish it, but it never has come that way.
I'm Wang Choi, and Kanaga just mentioned me. So I used to work at the substation in Singapore and was organizing a conference. So in 2003, I had invited TK to speak. And then I can't remember, was it in between now and then, speaking at NTU, I also attended that. And I've been very privileged to have been to these three lectures over a span of 13 years. And it's very interesting to track the shift, of this moment. And the different kinds of perspectives. And so today, of course, very much telling the story through Michael Sullivan rather than, for instance, a personal journey in 2003, a institutional discussion. I'm blanking on the year, about 5-6 years ago, maybe? Yeah, so sort of in between. So it's very interesting to see this story bracketed in a couple of ways. One, very much from Sabapathy's own perspective here, from that kind of encounter, but very much a reading of Sullivan, and then in between, really thinking about the department, the art history department, sort of that never was born in Singapore. So I just wanted to just share that kind of comment, and also to just acknowledge this privilege of mine to have witnessed this story in its multiple dimensions.
Thank you. Next question.
Hi, my name is Jolene, and since it's quite rare to have you here, thank you for the lecture. It's sort of a follow-up from the first question. In your time in USM Penang, one might imagine that you played a role of like a Michael Sullivan there, and perhaps if you could share with us some of your recollections and reflections of that time, your relationship and dynamics with subsequent batches of teachers there, or peers, and yeah, thank you.
With pleasure, yes, thank you for that. Marion de Cruz is here, she was subjected to some of my teaching there, I don't know. 1972, a bunch of us, I'll name them, Robert Kroc, Peter Galenza, Chu Teng Beng, Lim Eng Hui, and I, were recruited to begin the fine arts section in the School of Humanities. There were two creative sections. One was the fine arts, the other was the performing arts. I was teaching all the courses in history of art. Eng Hui was in painting, Robert in photography, Peter Galenza sculpture, Chu Teng Beng printmaking. Among the first intake of students who have gone on, there were many, but two who probably have made a mark of some kind considerably in the art world are Ismail Hashim, the late Ismail Hashim, and, of course, the enigmatic now Zabas, who, is he here? No.
Zabas sends his regards, he couldn't make it. Sorry.
Zabas is what?
Zabas sends his regards, he couldn't make it. I got a text from him.
That would be Zabas, yes. Yes, it was to us at that time an exciting almost heroic moment. We have all just finished our formal schooling from various graduate schools, and this was our first full-time teaching appointment. And we thought we could shape the world, and there was a moment in USM from 72, in my reckoning, to about the mid-80s, when we did shape the world. And it was permissible to do so because of the organization and the then vice chancellor, Hamza Sendut, who was a tremendous visionary at that time. And the cohorts of students who emerged over four intakes that I was there from 72 to 80. I left in 80, I had to leave in 80 because I was an expatriate, I'm from Singapore, and one could have only three-term cycles, after which there was a possibility of, you know, you might be a permanent resident or a citizen, and the university did not want to front people like that at that time. The curriculum, I think, at that time stayed for quite a bit, and then the fine arts section and the performing arts turned into some other organization. I think it became a pusat or for education rather than educating undergraduates who are interested in developing knowledge about these two areas. Whether they became artists or not was not the primary concern. Here was a university, and I think the only university at that time, which considered the learning and the teaching of visual art and performing arts as a credible and legitimate exercise in the study of humanities, per se. Not that they are going to be dramatists or filmmakers, no. They are no more going to be that than history majors become professional historians or mathematicians become professional mathematicians. I cannot vouch as to what has happened in USM since then. Occasionally I hear an anecdote here and there. Subsequently, the indomitable Ritsa Piyadasa joined us, and that, on a very personal and professional note, cemented a very profound relationship and friendship, a rather demanding friendship between the two of us until he passed away. And it was in USM too that in 74, 75, that a few of us inaugurated a course on modern art in Malaysia. I think that was the first formally constituted undergraduate level course, as there was in the study of traditional theatres of Southeast Asia, contemporary and modern theatres of Southeast Asia. So similar trajectories were developed in USM in the fine arts. And it's at that time that the first texts began to be produced. Not that there were nothing written there. So because of that, there were three sources of writing. One was the Balai Seni Lukis Negara, especially after Jamal took over as a director. The second, of course, is the media. And the third was USM as the provider and the producer of texts. And personally, that moment came to a kind of a climax in my life with the jointly authored work which Billy mentioned in his introductory remarks, Modern Artists of Malaysia. The person who took over the art history course from me was Zakaria Ali, who continued that and I think produced very valuable written materials on Malaysian artists and art until his retirement from USM. And it was during USM too that the connection between the university and public cultural organizations like the Balai began to be cemented. And it was interesting at that time, I received an invitation from Zain Azahari, who was the chairman of the board of advisors of the Balai, inviting me to sit on the committee. And I wrote to him, "Tan Sri, thank you, but you must know I'm a Singaporean." He said, "I'm inviting you because you're an art historian." I don't think that's possible anymore, is it? I don't know. So those were the kinds of transactions that took place at that time. Yes, there was a museum. Yes, let me quickly, thank you, Valentine. This was again, Hamza Sendut facilitated that, the founding of a museum. It was intended to be a museum for all kinds of activities, not just visual arts, but visual arts came up the earliest and the quickest. And we got quite a bit of money at that time, 45,000 ringgit, you know, in 75 was a lot of money. And we were allowed to go and buy works for the collection. And fortuitously, not that we wished it, Frank Sullivan was selling his collection, what he had in Samat Gallery. And the heartbeat of that was taken out and bought from USM. It came from there, and subsequently that was built up. So I was suggesting to Simon's students yesterday that somebody should perhaps take on a dissertation on collections in public institutions. You know, so US University of Malaya, USM, and who knows. Has ITM a collection? I don't know. So it's possible. And what are they doing and what are they not doing? How about that? Maybe a thesis on the latter would be scandalously true. Are they? I don't know. Yeah, this is the problem with starting something and not continuing. Yes. And University of Malaya, I was relating this to Simon today, instituted, again probably with Unku Aziz, a residency in University of Malaya. And the first resident was Ibrahim Hussein at University of Malaya. Yes, and then we started at USM, and Latif Mohideen was the first resident there, and that's where the Archa Dinding began, Langkawi and Archa Dinding. Not surprisingly, Penang, Langkawi, the whole of the north became the topic of his poetic explorations, both poetry and visual arts. Yes, so yeah,
I think we have time for possibly one more question. If there's anyone. So one last question from the floor. No? Okay. Well, in that case, do you want to sort of say the closing?
On behalf of ILHAM, University of Malaya, Simon, Valentine, and myself, I just want to say thank you so much, Mr. Sabapathy, for being here this afternoon, for giving such a fascinating lecture, and for being the first speaker to inaugurate the series. I don't think we could have had a better start. So thank you so much. Yeah.